I can see a swath of sinners setting yonder, and they're acting like a pack of...
I never intended to be a lyricist. I always thought I would be a composer and write, you know, theater music like Jerry Bach or Julie Stein. And when I went to college, I went to Carnegie Mellon, and I was a drama major there. And at that school, they had an extracurricular organization, which was called Scotch and Soda, and they did an original musical every year. And so I signed up my freshman year, I auditioned, and I wound up co-writing the show the 4 years I was there. And over time, particularly after the first year when the good lyricists that I had been working with graduated, mm-hmm. I started hearing what other people were doing, and I thought, well, I can do better than that, and at least I can tell the story. So I sort of started to become a lyricist out of self-defense, and then I decided that I liked being able to tell the story myself. I guess my first show that I ever wrote anything for was, in fact, in 1969. It was a play called Butterflies Are Free, for which they needed a sort of folk song that the leading character was supposed to have written, and I got an opportunity to submit the song, and it was chosen. But really, my first opportunity was the score for Godspell, which was in 1971. And what had happened for me was that when I went to college, I started listening to pop music, which I really had not been too interested in before. It's a little untrue. I sort of started getting interested right towards the end of my high school experience with the advent of the Motown sound and the Beach Boys and the Beatles. But prior to that, that sort of old-time rock and roll, I just never responded to that. The four chords thing and the magic changes and everything in 6/8. I know other people just love that music, and I just thought it was really boring and I had no interest in it. And then, you know, suddenly I was hearing Burt Bacharach do those weird rhythmic things, and of course the early Beatles, and as I said, the Motown sound. So I started listening to that, and then all through college, this was the time of the advent of the great singer-songwriters of that period. So there was Laura Nyro, and there was Joni Mitchell, and there was Paul Simon, and there was James Taylor, and Leonard Cohen, and this is what I was listening to. So then when I started to get the opportunity to write for theater, this was the kind of music I wanted to use. And I didn't really think of it as a rebellion or changing what had gone before, but then I was surprised at the sort of initial response from some of the people who wrote about theater, who basically said, you can't do theater music like that. You can do it if you're doing Hair, or perhaps even Godspell, which is sort of like a review. But if you're really trying to tell a story and you're really trying to have characters, then they have to sing in this old traditional way that we know characters sing in musical theater. And I thought, well, I don't agree with that, and I don't think that has to be the case. It sounds silly to say this now, because of course now everything playing on Broadway is basically a pop score. But at that time, it was sort of controversial. Could you do that and still tell a theatrical story? So I came to realize that it was maybe a little bit more of flying in the face of tradition than I was originally aware.